Simon Leviev's success came from his uncanny ability to trick people into thinking he was something that he wasn't. His apparent life of luxury, as fraudulent as it was, proved attractive to the women he matched with on Tinder. He was the ideal match to them, and in an instant, swipe right, if you will. In the minds of his victims, the fact that he had chosen to swipe right on them was nothing short of remarkable. If his Tinder profile piqued their interest, the overpriced dates he took them on sent them head over heels. He gave the women he matched with lavish gifts with eye-popping price tags. Their rich new boyfriend made a point to take them on adventurous nights out, dinners on private planes, and joyrides in luxury cars. Leviev explained his tremendous wealth by telling his victims he was the son of well-known Israeli billionaire Lev Avernovich Leviev. The real Leviev was nicknamed the King of Diamonds because of his portfolio of investments in the diamond mining industry. The Tinder swindler took this as an opportunity to call himself the Prince of Diamonds, lying to his dates about how he made big bucks as a diamond dealer. The rich guy with rich parents persona that Simon Leviev portrayed was a complete and utter lie. Simon Leviev was not even his real name. He was actually Shimon Hayut, a fugitive who had been on the run from the Israeli authorities for years. Before he ever called himself the Prince of Diamonds, Hayut faced unrelated theft, forgery, and fraud charges, calling cards for his future Tinder swindling. He escaped Israel before they sentenced him and ultimately settled in Finland. It wasn't long before he found himself in even more hot water when the Finnish police were on his tail for defrauding three more victims. He was sentenced to 2 years behind bars and eventually returned to Israel in 2017. However, he fled the country once again. Back on the run, Hayut decided it was time to adopt a new alias to conceal his criminal identity from the outside world. He started calling himself Simon Leviev and roamed Europe in search of people to swindle with his made-up backstory and seemingly endless access to cash. In reality, he only had eyes for his victims' cash, and he used the web of lies he'd spun to con them into giving it to him. One of the innocent people caught up in Leviev's sinister scam was a young Norwegian woman called Cecily Fageloy. She'd moved to London to write her master's thesis, loving it so much she made it her permanent home. Cecily and Leviev linked up on Tinder one night, and before long, she found herself swept up in his intoxicating lifestyle. During their initial face-to-face meeting, Leviev invited his date to accompany him to Bulgaria. He told her he had a business meeting for his company, LLD Diamonds. Cecily was overwhelmed, but she decided to tag along on this sudden trip despite having just met the guy. As Cecily herself tells the story, Leviev had irresistible charisma, making it hard for her to say no to his outlandish requests. He was surrounded by his posse the entire time they were together. His bodyguard, business partner, and personal security all boarded his private plane en route to Bulgaria. Cecily has said that this was actually quite comforting to her. The fact that Leviev had a group of people willing to jump into action at his every beck and call only made him seem more credible and trustworthy in her eyes. After the trip to Bulgaria, Cecily flew back to London. Even though they continued to flirt with each other daily, she questioned whether or not she'd ever see Leviev again. As it turned out, their relationship was pretty much the only thing Leviev was concerned with, but not for any of the reasons she hoped or expected. A week after their first meeting, Leviev hopped on board his private jet and made his way back to London to see her. Cecily honestly believed she had found the one. She was reassured by the fact that her new boyfriend always seemed to have time for her. It all seemed almost too good to be true, but Cecily was falling in love and she truly believed that Leviev felt the same way. Roughly a month into their relationship, however, he told her that some of his competitors in the diamond industry had started making death threats against him. He claimed the threats were so serious that he didn't feel safe going to London to see her. Leviev made a surprise visit to her in Oslo while she was there on business, but things started getting weird after that. He asked Cecily for her credit card information, claiming his security team had advised him to get rid of any digital trail his enemies might use to get him. Cecily bought this excuse and gladly gave Leviev her card. It seemed like things were getting back to normal after that, and they even made plans to move in together once the security situation was taken care of. Things finally came to a head after the couple had been dating for 3 months. Leviev started sending Cecily pictures of him and his bodyguard covered in blood from apparent fights with his rivals. He asked her for even more money to help him get out of Dodge. She obliged without a moment's hesitation, even taking out a massive loan to help her boyfriend out of trouble. In the end, she sent Leviev over $200,000 with the expectation that he would pay her back in short order. But that never happened. Leviev sent Cecily a bank statement showing he paid back the loan, but the document was fake. She sensed something was very wrong and ultimately cut off all communication with the man she believed to be her loving boyfriend. She reported him to the authorities in both Norway and England, and that's when she learned Leviev had already been convicted on 3 counts of fraud for situations that were eerily similar to the one she currently found herself in. As it turns out, Leviev had been operating a kind of romance Ponzi scheme. He used money he stole from one victim to bankroll the lavish lifestyle to charm the next victim. The money he swindled from the second person would go toward his pursuit of a third, and so on. According to Cecily's bank statements, Leviev used the money he stole from her to pay for airline tickets for another female acquaintance, a Swedish woman named Pernilla Schloholm. Leviev first got in touch with Pernilla on Tinder in March of 2018, which happened to be right in the middle of his relationship with Cecily. While their involvement was romantic at first, Pernilla says her relationship with Leviev transformed into a close friendship as the months went on. Much like Cecily, she was fascinated by the scammer's suave, larger-than-life personality. The two had known each other for 8 months before he ever asked her for money. Leviev, it seems, had a consistent MO. He lured victims in with his extravagant lifestyle, meticulously earned their trust for months, then exploited that trust by stealing their cash. Pernilla first realized that she'd been conned when she was contacted by the Norwegian newspaper Verdensgang, better known as VG. They were already hot on Leviev's trail with the help of Cecily, who had offered VG journalists access to her digital correspondence with the swindler. Now it was Pernilla's turn to help catch Leviev before he zeroed in on another victim. VG coordinated with Pernilla to bring an end to Leviev's con. She decided to confront him once and for all, allowing VG exclusive access to the whole thing. Pernilla traveled to Oslo and gave her former best friend a call. The VG cameras were on for this climactic confrontation, during which Leviev insisted that Pernilla's claims about him were nothing but lies. Throughout the contentious phone call, Leviev can be heard shouting angrily at Pernilla as she tries to get him to admit to his misdeeds. He refuses to do so and instead challenges her to show him any evidence of the crime she's accusing him of. Unfortunately for the Tinder swindler, Pernilla had kept the receipts and could verifiably prove that Leviev had used money belonging to Cecily and others to pay for gifts he had given to Pernilla during their relationship. Leviev even goes so far as to threaten Pernilla for double-crossing him, saying she'll pay for her betrayal with more than just money. However, it seems those threats were empty, as the VG hit piece on Leviev proved to be his downfall. By telling Cecily's and Pernilla's stories, the newspaper shined a massive spotlight on the swindler that made his international notoriety soar through the roof. In 2019, Israeli police finally caught up with the swindler following a joint investigation with Interpol and Greek law enforcement. Leviev had used a fake passport in Greece, which resulted in him being taken into custody and extradited to Israel. He had initially fled the country to avoid standing trial on fraud allegations, but now he found himself right back where he started with brand new criminal charges to his name. It's been reported that Leviev's Tinder scams from 2017 to 2019 resulted in the theft of $10 million from his various victims. Who knows how much the Prince of Diamonds stole in total since his defrauding days began back in 2011. Even though he was caught dead to rights, Leviev continued to deny he was ever involved in the scams he was being accused of. He claimed that the victims of his crime were the true monsters and that their allegations against him spawned from pure selfishness. In December of 2019, he was sentenced to 15 months behind bars, but only served 5 months before being granted early release. The decision shocked his victims, who felt like the justice system had stabbed them in the back. An outraged Pernilla Schloholm vented her frustrations in an interview with the Israeli news outlet Channel 12. Another victim, identified only by the initial D, was so hurt by Leviev's release that she openly wished for the con artist to die from the coronavirus so he wouldn't hurt any more women. Ouch. A woman known solely as Victim A felt betrayed by the court's decision to grant an early release for Leviev. She expressed her belief that he would undoubtedly get back to his swindling ways in no time. Victim A was soon proven correct. It seems Leviev's commitment to lying about anything and everything has no boundaries. Even after spending time in prison for his constant scheming, he got right back to lying, this time to get an early COVID-19 vaccine. In December of 2020, he made his way over to a vaccination center in the city of Nybrak. Although he didn't actually qualify to receive inoculation, he impersonated a medical worker and managed to sneak in to get vaccinated before he was supposed to. Simon Leviev has continued to lie and lie as if lying was his full-time job. His behavior suggests he hasn't actually learned anything from his past convictions. It seems almost inevitable that he'll find himself caught up in another ruse soon enough. Since the last time we left the Tinder swindler, he was under arrest by Greek police. The 28-year-old Israeli, whose birth name is Shimon Hayut, was traveling with a fake Israeli passport and was arrested at the Athens airport. Airport employees were notified of an international warrant for his arrest on fraud, theft, and forgery charges. He was later deported to Israel. He presented himself as the son of the multi-million-dollar Russian-Israeli diamond tycoon Lev Leviev. He used this false identity to defraud multiple women he met on Tinder out of millions of dollars. When word of his arrest got out, Leviev's picture was plastered all over the internet. The swindler left a trail of European victims in his path, stealing upwards of $10 million. He found his victims on Tinder and wooed them with expensive dinners, private jets, and luxury hotels. They thought they were dating a successful businessman. In reality, he was paying for his fancy dates with another woman's money, using a strange blend of romance scam meets Ponzi scheme. Nobody can knock the swindler's white-collar creativity. Netflix cashed in on the story with its documentary, The Tinder Swindler, featuring interviews from three women Leviev manipulated. Cecile Fajelhoy, Aileen Charlotte, and Pernilla Sojholm had their life savings stolen from underneath them. The doc was immediately successful, hitting the top 10 list in 92 countries and scoring 45.8 million hours of global viewing time in 1 week. An interesting story for sure, but Netflix fame comes at a price. Leviev is now an international celebrity reveling in his newfound fame and recognition. It's probably not the outcome these women hoped for when they offered to be part of the Netflix documentary. The Tinder Swindler was so successful that Netflix is now in early talks of adapting the documentary into a full-length feature film. In 2011, an Israeli arrest warrant went out for Leviev on theft, forgery, and fraud charges. He never had his day in court because he had already fled to Europe. In 2017, a new criminal case was opened against him, and of course, he never showed up. In 2019, after international law enforcement finally found and arrested him in Greece, Leviev received a 15-month prison sentence. However, he only served 5 months in prison and was released on good behavior. He apparently now lives in Tel Aviv as a free man. According to social media, he maintains his lavish lifestyle and has a new model girlfriend, Kate Conlon. Tinder confirmed that he's been permanently banned from the site. But there's a dark side to Netflix fame. Instead of keeping his head down, the swindler had other ideas. He has been cashing in on his infamy with various side hustles. Leviev signed up for Cameo, a website where people can pay celebrities to send personalized videos and messages to loved ones. In his first 3 days on the platform, Leviev made over $30,000. He charges between $200 and $300 per video, more than most other celebs on the platform, yet his inbox still floods with requests. He charges a whopping $1,400 for any company-sponsored messages. But it doesn't stop there. He charges $20,000 for club appearances and has a variety of requirements, including bottle service, a private jet, rooms at a 5-star hotel, and chauffeured SUVs. He also needs 2 security guards to be near him at all times. Leviev's newest side hustle is selling NFTs. On OpenSea, the largest NFT marketplace, Leviev promotes an NFT called Peter Hurt. The NFT depicts his bodyguard, Peter, sitting in the back of an ambulance with a wound to his head. Simon showed his female victims the same photo of an injured Peter to prove that his enemies were out to get him. The image first made its rounds to gain pity money from the women he was swindling and has reached world fame through the documentary. Now, Leviev is looking to use the documentary's success to his advantage. Along with the NFT, Leviev also launched his own website, selling merchandise inspired by the documentary and his crimes. Some shirts say, "My enemies are after me," which was one of his favorite messages to send to victims. Another says, "If she really loves you, she'll take out a $20,000 loan for you." Leviev's new business ventures are definitely not what Pernilla, Aileen, and Cecile intended when they agreed to participate in The Tinder Swindler. The documentary was supposed to shine a light on how a remorseless man can defraud people out of millions through an online dating site. The women in the film thought it would end his crimes and warn others about romance scams. Instead, Leviev just found new ways to keep up his expensive lifestyle, and this time, it's totally legal. Leviev looks to his newfound fame to his advantage. Whether it's good or bad press, he knows he can cash in on it. He signed a contract with talent manager and former adult film star Gina Rodriguez from LA, who helps D-listers make a name for themselves. Her former clients include Anthony Weiner's former texting scandal pal, Lindsay Lohan's parents, Octomom, and some Real Housewives cast members. Rodriguez's goal is to make sure that her clients are on some kind of list. That's all that matters. Her mission statement is to turn that 15 minutes of fame into a solid hour. Rodriguez's resume is an impressive list of pot-stirring D-list celebrity scandals. She encouraged Octomom to make an adult tape, knowing that it would generate money to help her take care of her kids. She booked the estranged Michael and Dina Lohan on a show called The Test, on which they argued about each other's poor behavior and bad habits. She also represented the girls involved in the Tiger Woods and Charlie Sheen cheating scandals. As of last month, Rodriguez has a new client. It's none other than the Tinder Swindler, who wants to partner with Rodriguez and use his infamy to launch a Hollywood career. After receiving negative backlash from the documentary, he asked people to keep an open mind and heart until he explained his story side. Rodriguez is helping him do just that. Rodriguez and Leviev are trying to get him a book deal and his own dating show where women can compete for his love. There's also talk of a podcast about dating in the 21st century. But his dating pool might be a bit limited considering he's already been banned from Tinder and most other dating apps like Hinge and Bumble. Since swindling the women depicted in the Netflix documentary, Simon has started a website to provide consulting advice to paying clients. He stated that he's a real estate mogul with a net worth in the tens of millions. He claims he made his fortune through the housing market and Bitcoin, but his website has since been deactivated. Leviev's Instagram account has also been deactivated. Still, there's no shortage of fake accounts claiming to be Simon Leviev official. But Leviev wants to tell his own story in a more curated way. He was asked to be part of the documentary but declined, believing that the film already had an angle that would paint him in a negative light. Leviev wants to tell his story without biases. Netflix communicated with Leviev throughout the making of the film. However, he never showed any remorse for what he did. His victims believe that Leviev's side of the story will just be him claiming innocence and completely denying any wrongdoing. He'll probably shift the blame onto the women he conned. One of the women in the documentary, Cecile, took out $250,000 worth of loans on his behalf that he never repaid. A Norway native and UK resident, Cecile is bankrupt in England and still struggles with her creditors in Norway. When told to take responsibility for her actions, Cecile points to how her financial well-being has been completely destroyed by Leviev in not one, but two European countries. She reached out to Leviev with compassion, hoping that maybe he would soften and try to help her out. Instead, he replied saying her lies made him a superstar. Perhaps the most painful part of the story is that Leviev has never, and probably will never, admit to what he did. You might think that the subject of a scathing Netflix documentary would be cradling his head in his hands and working hard to pay off debts, but that's far from the truth for Leviev. After the doc aired, he was seen walking freely around Israel in a Gucci jacket shopping for sports cars. He went to a luxury car dealership in an SUV with a trail of bodyguards behind him. Some of the Ferrari models he was looking at, such as the 296 GTB, come with a $250,000 price tag. Though he never bought any of the cars, Leviev's Gucci jacket, car shopping habits, and a barrage of bodyguards show that Leviev is far from strapped for cash. Remember that NFT Leviev is selling? The one of his bodyguard, Peter, in the back of an ambulance? Well, while Leviev profits on the photo and Netflix rakes in cash from the Tinder swindler, Peter isn't getting anything and he's not so happy. Peter is now suing Netflix because he doesn't like how they portrayed him in the documentary. His lawyer says that the film implies Peter helped Leviev scam his victims. In reality, Peter had nothing to do with it, or so he claims. He was hired as a bodyguard and was merely doing his job. He didn't ask questions about Simon's business dealings, he just made sure he was protected at all times. Leviev simply used Peter's story and image as a pawn to get more cash from his victims. Parafianowicz claims that Netflix never reached out to Peter for comment. Still, he would have appreciated the opportunity to share his story. His lawyer also says that Netflix used Peter's image without permission, violating his human rights and causing severe mental distress. His lawyer claims Peter had nothing to do with Leviev's cons, but is now associated with criminal wrongdoing due to the Netflix documentary. He's struggling to find work as a bodyguard because of the film. He feels Netflix stripped him of his image, anonymity, and personal data. For those reasons, Peter is suing Netflix for $5.6 million. Aileen, Pernilla, and Cecile have started a GoFundMe page to recuperate the money they lost to Leviev. The fundraiser is well on its way to its $800,000 goal, but this is just the tip of the iceberg. A recent study showed that in 2021 alone, Americans lost $1 billion in romance scams. But while these three women struggled to repay their debts, Netflix and Leviev are cashing in. While Leviev may fade into obscurity, there's the real possibility that he won't, like other Netflix famous convicts like the Tiger King. After all, Joe Exotic got a second season. Leviev is wanted by police in Israel and is under investigation for fraud in Sweden, England, Germany, Denmark, and Norway. Yet, he walks the streets as a free man in Tel Aviv, shopping for Ferraris and taking Kate Conlon on expensive dates. Though he might be banned from swindling Tinder matches, Leviev is still conning the public. Let's face it, we'd all watch this guy's dating show. He knows it. Gina knows it. And Netflix knows it. Any press is good press, and nobody epitomizes that more than Simon, the Tinder Swindler Leviev. Tinder Swindlers are all over the world. Who are the worst scammers who specialize in fleecing unlucky women who are just looking for love? Let's get right into it. Number 5. Brazilian Tinder Swindler. He stole the hearts and savings of 7 women via Tinder. Then he led the police on a high-speed chase through the streets of Sao Paulo, Brazil in September 2022. But no one expected it to end the way it did. Renan Augusto Gomez decided to go by Augusto Keller on the online dating apps Tinder, Happn, and Lovo. Just like the Netflix famous Tinder Swindler, Simon Leviev, Augusto mainly targeted upper-middle-class white women between 40 years old. He used a sob story to get them to pity him and offered their money. Augusto posed as a civil engineer who was looking for love but was plagued by trauma after his German parents died in a car accident in Brazil. He claimed to be raised as an orphan. His profile also mentioned how he loved to cook and he was only interested in a serious long-term relationship. It seemed like Augusto took his relationship seriously. He went to the women's homes and met their families. Once he earned his victims' trust, Augusto asked them for money. Once he got it, he ghosted them right away. He said he had financial issues with the bank or that he owed tax money to the Special Department of Federal Revenue of Brazil. One woman says that Augusto stole more than £35,000 over the course of their relationship. Another woman said that Augusto fled with her money after they decided to go into business together. But the ruse ended when he swindled one woman, a teacher, out of $28,000. They dated for about 4 months until he mysteriously disappeared with her money. When she called the police on him, she admitted to being suspicious of Augusto for a while, since he was always getting a new cell phone. Police tracked down Augusto driving through the streets of Sao Paulo. Augusto started driving away, beginning a high-speed car chase with several marked police cars. Eventually, they caught up with him and rammed into the back of his car, causing Augusto's car to ram into 3 others. Thankfully, everyone was okay. Number 4. Canadian Tinder Swindler. Salim Damji is a scammer extraordinaire, and he found a new way to make a quick buck. He started romancing women in the Greater Toronto Area, and you guessed it, he convinced them to lend him money. Damji became the leader of a romance and investment Ponzi scheme that cost his 20 victims $1.2 million. Damji and one of his victims, Melissa, met in September 2013. He said he was an RBC investment banker and asked if she wanted to invest with him. She said no that night, but after maintaining a relationship mostly over the phone phone for a year, she decided she could trust him with her money. She was caring for a sick relative and could use the extra income. She sent him $50,000 and continued to send him smaller payments. Melissa gave Damji a total of $67,000. Damji promised that her investment would generate big profits, but she started growing suspicious. He was supposed to meet her for dinner on Valentine's Day, but never showed up. He said he had to fly to India last minute to be with his parents after a near-fatal car crash that left both his mother and father in a vegetative state. But when Melissa tested him, he always had the right answer. She asked him the time, wherever he was, and he was always right. Then he started asking Melissa to send money for him to build a school in Ethiopia, which was of interest to her. She gave him a few thousand toward the project, but when she started asking for money back, Damji said his accounts were frozen because the Canada Revenue Agency was investigating him. Melissa took matters into her own hands. She called private investigators and found nothing on the fake name he was using, Salman Darcy. So they continued exchanging flirty messages, with Melissa believing that he didn't have a record. Eventually, though, he stopped responding. A few months later, Melissa received a message from another woman asking her to stop sending messages to her boyfriend. A few emails later, Damji's supposed girlfriend revealed his real name. That's when Melissa found out about his sordid past. By the time she realized she was scammed out of her life savings, Damji was on the run, and her money was long gone. Melissa eventually found out that all of her money was used toward Damji's gambling addiction. For Damji, scamming was a lifestyle, and he had a routine. Damji would either go to Aurora's fancy restaurant and dance club Greystones, or use the online dating app Plenty of Fish to find his victims. While it originally appeared to investigators like a romance scheme that swindled unsuspecting women out of thousands, turned out that it was actually a Ponzi scheme. Damji told women he was an investment banker and promised various women that if they invested with him, he would bring them generous returns. Damji gave his victims an initial payout to show that their investments were profitable. But then, when they gave him more money to invest, he disappeared. He gave a pitch similar to Richard Gere's in Pretty Woman. He claimed that he bought companies, broke them up, and sold their assets for a profit. He promised to help his victims get out of debt and earn a higher return on investment. One of Damji's accomplices convinced a woman at a bar to invest $50,000, which was used to pay off the initial returns of the other victim. Damji was no stranger to the justice system. In 2002, he scammed thousands of Ismaili Muslims out of millions of dollars. He claimed that his company, Strategic Trading System, had a new teeth whitening technology that was sure to make every investor a millionaire. He promised that Colgate Palmolive would eventually buy the technology for $400 million and double everyone's investment. Damji guaranteed a ridiculous 2,000% return on investment. Ismaili Muslims from all over Canada wanted to invest in Damji's scam, some even throwing $100 bills into his hands as they stood outside a mosque. But instead of working on teeth whitening technology, Damji was living the high life. He lived in an $800,000 luxury condo at Palace Pier and spent evenings squandering away his victims' money via online casinos. He also bought a strip mall, luxury cars, and homes for relatives. Members of the close-knit Ismaili Muslim community were at first hesitant to go to the police, but did once they became certain that they were duped. Investors found out that he scammed at least 6,000 people and were able to recover $350,000 from Damji's internet casino account based in Costa Rica. Damji was sentenced to 7.5 years in jail after he pleaded guilty to swindling $42 million from 866 people in Canada's Ismaili community. The total number of victims from around the world was estimated to be closer to 6,000 in a scam worth at least $69 million. Investigators believe the total financial loss to be closer to $100 million. Since Damji already spent some time in prison, he only had 6 years and 3 months left to serve. His victims believe this sentence was nowhere near enough. Police began investigating Damji in 2014 when a victim reported that a man in Aurora convinced her to invest more than $50,000 in his company. But once she sent him the money, he was uncontactable. Officers realized that she wasn't the only one. Several other victims had been scammed in the same way by the same people. In 2015, 4 men and 1 woman were arrested in connection to Damji's romance investment scheme. Altogether, 20 women lost at least $12 million. Yaoming Liang, Shafin Damji, Tatiana Kranova, and Ansari Farhan were among the suspects arrested for the crimes. Damji was charged with several fraud charges, forgery, and providing a false statement in writing. Number 3. Aussie Tinder Swindler. Grant Greentree scammed multiple women out of thousands of dollars through online dating platform. He was on a roll in Australia until he was exposed by none other than his daughter. When Kim Dalquin downloaded Bumble, she was looking for a soulmate. What she found was a scammer. A few right swipes into her search for love, Kim matched with a McLean, who claimed that he was a successful businessman with a large international property portfolio. As they started to get to know each other, Macklin revealed his real name to be Grant Greentree. Despite the red flags, Kim couldn't ignore the deep connection she made with Grant. She was impressed by his success, so when he asked to borrow money, she never doubted that he would pay her back. Every time she expressed any concerns, he had the perfect answer. He promised that he would receive a big payment once he turned 60. In the meantime, though, Kim was footing the bill for luxury vacations and million-dollar mansions. And when Grant said he wanted Kim to meet his daughter, Isabella, he told Kim an emotional story about how his first wife, Elizabeth, Isabella's mother, died of cancer. Kim and Grant got married in Yarra Valley in 2020. But Isabella said her mother was very much alive. As Isabella and Kim sat in the backseat of Grant's car, Isabella asked her dad to turn up the radio and air conditioning so he couldn't hear her telling Kim about her dad's lies. That's when Grant's web of lies started to completely unravel. For Isabella, this was nothing new. Her childhood was filled with a revolving door of women. 1 year into his marriage with Kim, she realized that Grant, the man she thought was her forever, was just spinning a web of lies that left her close to broke. When she confronted Grant about a divorce, the loving, caring man she once thought he was completely disappeared. He became angry and threatening. Kim filed a domestic violence order against him to protect herself. Another one of Grant's ex-girlfriends, Melissa Sexton, said she had an on and off relationship with Grant for more than 25 years. Finally ended when he promised to pay back the $33,000 he owed her once he started a new job. She never saw one cent of it, but now she absolutely despises him. His other exes agree. His first wife, who chose to remain anonymous, filed a restraining order against him in 2008 after he allegedly assaulted her. She says she still owed over $400,000 in child support, which would be a drop in the bucket for Grant if his so-called wealth was real. Grant's second wife also applied for a restraining order just a year into their marriage. Grant's lies were not confined to Australia. He began a relationship with an American woman, Trisha Connors, who got pregnant shortly after meeting Grant. Her son, now 23 years old, has no relationship with his father. Connors is grateful that she got out of that relationship when she did. She called Grant's behaviors sociopathic. Kim tells other women who meet Grant to run fast. Number 2. South African Tinder Swindler. In 2022, Aman Namera conned at least 3 women in South Africa out of their money. Of course, he found his victims through Tinder, which earned him the easy nickname, the South African Tinder Swindler, in the news. Namera took his dates on lavish dates in an attempt to convince them of his wealthy lifestyle. Then he asked to borrow money and promised to pay it back. He went so far as to meet his dates as friends and family, convincing them that he was a trustworthy and kind partner. Many of the women were wooed by Namera's charm and fancy dates. A single mother of 2 just came out of a stressful relationship when she started talking to Namera. They met for lunch. She thought he was a sweetheart. In August of 2020, Namera told her he was struggling financially. He asked to borrow 15,000 rand. Namera promised to pay it back by the weekend. He continued asking for money from her with the promise to pay it back. Eventually, Namera owed the woman 52,000 rand plus an additional 60,000 rand worth of items from her boutique. One of the big ticket products was a Rolex watch worth 10,000 rand. Meanwhile, Namera promised another woman a romantic getaway. But first, he needed some money for the booking. She gave him 16,000 rand and he left her stranded at the airport. The woman took to social media to express her anger. Soon, other women started coming forward with similar experiences. Namera, originally from Uganda, didn't just steal money. He swindled his matches out of jewelry and clothing too. He told his Tinder matches that he was a millionaire in the fuel industry who owned a Bentley and had several properties in Johannesburg, South Africa. He said he was involved in international business. Eventually, authorities caught wind of Namera's scam. He was arrested and charged with fraud in March 2022. Number 1. Tinder Swindler Stoppers. We're about to do a 180 right now. Instead of focusing on the Tinder Swindlers, we're going to discuss a couple of girls who busted a Tinder swindler. 2 sisters from New Zealand, Emma and Sarah Ferris, teamed up to stop a Tinder swindler from stealing $300,000 from Emma. Well, sort of. Emma matched with Andrew Tonks Thompson on Tinder in 2018, and they hit it off right away. But little known to the single mother of 2, Andrew was living a double life as a con man. Several restaurants and former employers had claims against Andrew. In 2007, he was charged with stealing after he sold a company car and used the money to buy a motorbike. He was sentenced to 100 hours of community service. He warned Emma not to look him up online because he had been the victim of identity theft. He made fake financial documents to show her that he was a successful entrepreneur, former AFL player, and professional wakeboarder. So when he told Emma he wanted to invest in property with her, she trusted him. She gave him $50,000. Right as Emma gave him another $250,000, she learned that her boyfriend and investment partner was a liar and a convicted con man. Instead of confronting him right away, Emma decided to play along with his game. When she asked for the money back, Andrew promised to pay it back as soon as he finished his latest foreign spy mission, which was also a lie. He wrote her a letter saying that he was a spy for a counterterrorism unit, which is why he had to be so secretive. She gathered enough evidence to bring to the authorities. New Zealand police found Andrew as he landed in Christchurch and brought him directly to the Christchurch men's prison. Andrew, thinking that Emma still had no idea of his past, told a police officer to call her and say that he wasn't going to make it to their date the next day. Andrew was sentenced to 28 months in jail for stealing $300,000 from Emma, in addition to fraud against a Queenstown restaurant owner and alcohol company. He was ordered to pay Emma $63,800 and an additional $8,000 for emotional harm, still far less than what she was owed. But Emma later learned that Andrew successfully appealed and got the $8,000 reduced to $5,000, and he was out on parole using the dating app Bumble. When Emma heard the news that Andrew was out of jail and ready to target more women, she sprung into action. She teamed up with her sister to start a podcast called Conning the Con, dedicated to telling her story and warning women about scammers lurking on dating apps. By broadcasting her experience, Emma learned about several other women that Andrew swindled in the past. One of Emma's most important tips is to listen to your gut. If you feel like there are red flags, you're probably right. She also said that if something doesn't feel right, look up your date's name online and ask them about their dating intentions. Most of all, Emma encourages her listeners to be comfortable by themselves before looking for a partner. She fell right into a scammy relationship with her ex where she didn't quite realize that she was paying for everything, and he pretended to be a male model world-class surgeon to get almost a dozen women to pay for everything. Let's get right to some of the other most terrible Tinder swindlers you'd never want to meet. Number 4, my strange addiction. Amir Tofang Sazan used photos of a male model to pose as a world-class surgeon and a CPS barrister on an online dating site to dupe almost a dozen unsuspecting victims into lending him cash, which he never paid back. Tofang Sazan was first jailed for 7 years and 9 months after being convicted of 15 counts of fraud. While on day release from an open prison, which seems like the opposite of a prison should be, he got a hold of a phone and started conning women again, earning another 3 years. Tofang Sazan was released from prison early and started his scam up again for a third time. Tofang Sazan had previously been convicted 9 times for 43 offenses over the last 13 years. Tofang Sazan's first scheme used the stolen identities of his former bosses to set up fake job interviews with women hoping to start in secretarial roles, who he later invited for drinks, and it largely failed. Tofang Sazan did trick one dating app victim into having relations with him by convincing her that he was a friend of the man she was seeing. And he claimed that his friend's ultimate fantasy was to see her be with other men, namely him. And that's exactly what she did. Later, while serving time in West Sussex, Tofang Sazan got a hold of a phone on day release and managed to con 3 more people into giving him money. Tofang Sazan was sentenced to an additional 3 years and was slapped with a criminal behavior order, CBO, banning him from using any online dating services. After serving less than half of his second sentence, Tofang Sazan was released and was back to his old ways, immediately contacting 3 of his former victims on WhatsApp and on Tinder. Tofang Sazan's most recent catfishing scam, where someone lies about their identity online, was discovered when a potential victim recognized the person in one of his stolen photos as someone she actually knew. Despite being banned from dating sites, Tofang Sazan had set up 2 dating profiles, using the same fake identities as before. Not only is he a scumbag, but he's lazy too. He was chatting with women on a phone registered with the police. He was charged with 6 counts of breaching his CBO by using Tinder and Bumble Bumble, owning two other unregistered phones, not disclosing he had a laptop, and not notifying police he wasn't staying at his registered address. After a thorough dressing down by the judge at his trial, Tafangzizan was deservedly branded a danger to women. Tafangzizan had been seeking to reestablish contact with three of his victims whom he perceived to be vulnerable and was now using a new persona to target them once again. An extract from a psychiatrist's report read at his trial noted that Tafangzizan held a sense of contradictory feelings towards women. On the one hand, he desired intimacy, but on the other hand, he felt disdain. One victim was conned out of £4,000 after Tafangzizan used Tinder to contact her and claimed to be a respected international trauma surgeon. Tafangzizan explained he had worked in hospitals all over the world, had a portfolio of properties, and a fleet of expensive cars. However, he was having cash flow problems at the moment and needed money to renew his medical registration. The victim agreed to help and then made repeated payments to him, which he promptly gambled away. Another victim was so convinced that their relationship was genuine, she gave Tafangzizan almost £15,000. The scumbag was released following his second conviction, and not 3 days later, he contacted two more women who actually had given evidence against him. After continued attempts to reach his former victims, Tafangzizan was finally arrested on suspicion of breaching the terms of his CBO and fraud. He's currently serving a 3-year sentence, and he's most likely still looking for love. Number 3. The worst gym manager ever. Black-ish star Jennifer Lewis was left embarrassed and humiliated after being caught in a romance scam where her boyfriend conned her into investing tens of thousands of dollars into a business that didn't exist. Lewis, 63, was one of several victims of gym manager Antonio Marriott Wilson, 57, who pleaded guilty to one count of wire fraud and has been accused of stealing from at least 4 other women. Lewis thought that Wilson was a charmer who was a godsend until she was faced with the harsh reality that he had stolen $50,000 and wasn't actually the Oscar-winning Navy SEAL Dr. Oxford-educated UCLA professor he claimed to be. We know, we're shocked too. Antonio Wilson, aka Dr. Tony Marriott, aka Bryce Carrington, names that sound like they were lifted from a soap opera, had convinced Lewis and 3 other women to invest in his fake sound design business, Ultimate FX, and his fake software company, Second Life. He had met 3 of his victims on Bumble, a Tinder-like dating app, and Lewis, who plays Ruby on the ABC sitcom Blackish, he met at the gym. Lewis found Wilson charming and handsome, and that he graduated from Oxford University, as well as being an ex-Navy SEAL, and was a professor at UCLA, was just gravy on top. All Lewis could think was that this man was sent to her from above, never once considering that he was too good to be true. Shortly into their romance, Wilson persuaded Lewis to invest over $50,000 in a film industry project. Apparently, our Oxford-educated ex-Navy SEAL professor was also an Oscar-winning sound editor. Never mind the fact he was working as a front desk manager at a health club. It's good to have a side gig. It wasn't until Lewis's friend got suspicious and started digging that his con was exposed. Lewis's friend discovered that Wilson had once lived under the name Bryce Carrington and lived in Pleasanton, California, where he purchased a lavish $2.7 million mansion, drove an elite fleet of expensive cars, and had claimed to have won 3 Oscars for sound editing work to help with his scam. While operating under the name Carrington, Wilson managed to convince 13 investors to invest over $4.5 million in his software company. But rather than growing to support his company, Wilson used the money to fund his lavish lifestyle. How unusual. It's like these guys all have the same manual. His scheme was uncovered when the IRS began an investigation into Wilson for tax evasion, which got him arrested. He served a 4-year sentence in federal prison, where Wilson rebranded himself a theologian and wrote a book under the name Dr. Tony Marriott. When Lewis learned she was scammed, she was devastated, embarrassed, and humiliated. From her point of view, how could an educated, world-traveled, successful, show business woman get conned out of $50,000? But Wilson had thoroughly researched her online and specifically targeted her before they even met. Lewis immediately went to the police, but she was told she couldn't press charges because she had written gift in the memo line of her checks as Wilson had instructed. Luckily, the FBI eventually got wind of the scam and Wilson was arrested. He pled guilty to wire fraud, was sentenced to 8 years in prison, and ordered to pay $272,000 in restitution. Number 2. Full of hot air. Richard Dexter of Highland Terrace, South Sea, UK, was on Tinder claiming he was a successful businessman selling biopharma technology and was worth £6.8 million. He was involved in Hollywood studios and he was immensely wealthy, owned private jets and expensive cars. It was there that Dexter met Amrita Sebastian, a wealthy business executive from Dubai by way of India, and he conned her into giving him more than £140,000 that was actually spent on his own debt and his lavish lifestyle. Dexter met Sebastian on the dating app in 2015 and had shared intimate information in order to gain her confidence and constantly bragged about his immense wealth. At one point in his outrageous brags, he mocked his friends. "I am 32. Most of my friends did college and uni. All of them have debts and worries and all earn £40,000 to £60,000. I bought a hot air balloon yesterday just because I could." You know, the normal type of thing you'd say about your friends when they have financial issues. Dexter first conned Sebastian out of £40,000 in 2015 when he said he had purchased a patent for a piece of scientific equipment called a bioreactor paddle, then later boasted of being on the verge of a £12 million leasing deal with 3M, but needed £68,000 investment up front. Dexter claimed the deal was worth £3.6 million and that Sebastian could benefit from 50% of this, and also promised Sebastian he would pay her £100,000 as interest over the course of 15 months. Dexter continued to ask Sebastian for more money to cover administration and legal fees, including when she was extremely ill in the hospital, until she had invested £141,500. Sebastian began to realize Dexter wasn't all who he said he was, but felt trapped into giving him money with the hope this would protect her investments. Eventually, she went to the police. During his trial, Dexter claimed the money went to his general day-to-day living and clearing a debt of £35,000. But it was also revealed that he had paid £15,000 to a classic car company, so he must have meant high-end day-to-day living. Dexter pretended to cry in court, claiming how deeply remorseful he was for his actions, but never reached out to Sebastian to apologize because he just couldn't bring himself to do it. The judge, thankfully, didn't buy it. Dexter was sentenced to 4.5 years and said that he had £200,000 and 3 cryptocurrencies to pay back his victim. In sentencing, Dexter's judge aptly stated that there was little sign of any remorse. He claimed that Dexter never spared a thought for her despite knowing about the state of her health, and he also continued to take her money without any hesitation. Number 1. Kel Bryan understands. Kel Bryan is a celebrity panelist on the popular UK talk show Loose Women. It's a show which is basically the UK version of The View, except with hosts who have more intelligent sounding accents. Kel can understand how someone can get scammed off Tinder. Without realizing how unhealthy her relationship was, Kel told her story of how she once helped out an ex-boyfriend financially when she was young and dumb. Kel thought everything was okie-dokie with the help, but when she got a call from her bank one dreary British morning, she learned the awful truth about her situation. On her TV show, Kel related how she was involved in a scam similar to the one run by Simon Hayut, or aka Simon Leviev, on Netflix's documentary The Tinder Swindler. At the time they were together, Kel and her boyfriend both were well off, but once Kel's ex lost his job, she began to support him fully. One thing led to another. Before she knew it, she was knee-deep in a very controlling relationship and was financially taken care of. The former Eternal singer trusted her partner so much that she eventually just gave her partner her credit card because she didn't want him to feel emasculated by having to ask her for money. Kel was only made aware of the financial situation when she received a call from the bank to question some transactions. When the bank calls you, it's never a friendly call to tell you that there was an error in your favor and you get to collect $200. That only happens in Monopoly. And don't sit near the bank and grab an extra $100 when no one's looking, because that's, you know, cheating. Kel's bank, predictably, was calling her because her beau had been excessively spending to the point that he was literally buying cars. Kel felt that at the time, she was making the right decision to support this person she loved, but with how deeply controlling the relationship was, she didn't feel like she was making clear decisions. Unfortunately, hindsight is the sight with the clearest view. Kel was so humiliated by her ordeal that she never told her parents or even pursued recouping her huge financial losses with her bank. Kel learned that the greatest crimes are often not committed, not from giving in miles, but giving in inches. In the end, all Kel was left with was embarrassment and a broken heart. This guy pretended to be a doctor and scammed over 30 women for over $1 million. And he's been convicted 66 times for fraud. Who are some of the best romance scammers out there? Let's get right to it. Number 4, Florida Tinder Swindler. Brian Bernard Wedgeworth was a Casanova scammer who duped over 30 women out of $1.3 million through his romance scamming. Brian Wedgeworth carried out his scam by targeting victims on social media networks. He took victims from every network he could find, including LinkedIn. He created fake aliases and profiles on these networks and lied that he was an accomplished surgeon looking to settle down. To gain the trust of the women he was about to scam, Brian would tell them that he would pay off their debt. He often said that he didn't want the women he wanted in his life to have any debt. These women would then give him their banking information because they believed that he wanted to pay off their mortgage and other associated debts. He made his scam even more believable by sending electronic payments to the bank accounts of these women. These payments were made through accounts with insufficient funds that had been closed by the banks. Unfortunately, there was a banking loophole that made the women get alerts that their debts had been paid in full, even though the payments themselves had not been cleared. After making these payments, he would convince his victims to lend him cash to settle some bills. Sometimes he said that he didn't have access to his funds because he was fighting a medical malpractice lawsuit. Other times, he said that he no longer had any cash because he paid off these women's debts. Many of his victims would then lend him huge amounts of cash, and he would ask them to deposit the cash into bank accounts that had his real name. He usually told them that the owner of this bank account was a business partner. One of his victims was a woman named Takesha Johnson. According to Ms. Johnson, Brian lied that he was a thoracic surgeon and then lied that he had paid off her mortgage for her. Once he got her to trust him, he convinced her to buy him a Rolex so that she could begin to stabilize her credit. After Ms. Johnson bought the watch, she realized that she had been scammed because his mortgage payment for her failed to clear. That was when she began to dig around and realized the man she was in love with was a serial fraudster. By then, he was already long gone from her life. Brian didn't just tell fantastic lies to scam women, he also told fantastic lies to stop his shady past from being discovered. When one of his victims confronted him after discovering that he was an ex-convict, he lied and told her that his arrest wasn't real and that he was merely an undercover cop who worked with the police to catch corrupt correctional facility officers. He said that his conviction was all part of his cover and that the only reason he wasn't practicing medicine was that he was still undercover. All in all, Brian was able to scam over 30 women for about $1.3 million. In the end, he was apprehended by the police and was sentenced to 9 years in prison for his efforts. This sentence was also to be followed by 3 years of supervised release. The judge ordered him to pay over $1 million in restitution. Number 3. King Khan. The wedding looked like anyone's dream wedding. Then 61-year-old bride Carol Goodall was in an immaculate white dress, and her husband Gary Rogers, who was 6 years older, was in a charcoal black suit that looked amazing as well. The whole scene was complete with around 70 attendees made up of family and friends. It was picture perfect and was the kind of wedding anyone could seem to want. However, this wedding was not what it seemed. It wasn't even a lawful wedding, and the man standing at the altar wasn't named Gary Rogers. He went by a different legal name, and Gary Rogers was just one of his many aliases. His legal name was Richard Robinson, and this wedding was just another one of his many romance scams. Richard Robinson was a professional fraudster who targeted older women with middle-class income through internet dating sites. He had been a serial scammer for over 10 years, where he would continually scam women for money. Richard had been scamming women by telling them tall tales of love since at least 2013, when he was jailed in North Wales for defrauding 4 other women. He told the women the same old and tired story he told most of his victims. He said he was a widowed businessman whose wife had died of cancer and that he was waiting for a big payout from his insurers. After a short period of romance, he usually proposed and then would start requesting cash to sort out completely fabricated complicated bills. He was able to scam these four women of £18,000 through these false stories. And he did all that within 2 years. He was also jailed for securing about £750 in loans from banks with false identities. But that's just the scams that the police can prove. According to Barbara Salvage, a police constable who had traced Richard's criminal history, he probably started scamming as far back as the 80s. And most of his scams have the same MO. He befriends women, gets them to fall in love with him, and then borrows money from them without paying it back. Richard was no amateur at the fraud game, and sometimes he was running these romance scams with three or four women at the same time. But even the best criminals slip up, and Richard's slip up came when he met Carol Goodall. He met her on an internet dating site like many of his victims, and she had taken a quick liking to him. At the end of her ordeal, Carol said that she had found it very easy to speak with him because they had a lot of things in common. What she didn't know was that scammers like Richard has a habit of scouting their potential victims and creating a persona they knew their victims would love. At first, Richard's attempt at scamming Carol went well, and he got her to agree to marry him. But a day before the marriage, he informed her that his divorce from his ex-wife was taking longer than expected, and their wedding would be a blessing ceremony instead of a wedding. Carol accepted this explanation because it sounded sincere and she had no reason to doubt him. But Richard was not sincere. He simply didn't want to get lawfully married to Carol, as that could legally implicate him and perhaps make Carol entitled to his assets. After convincing Carol to have a ceremony but not get legally married, he got to work on her. Before the wedding, he had convinced her to sell her house to foot the expenses of a motor company he had put in her name. He had also convinced her to part with around £60,000 she was saving for her children. After taking her money, he put her mind to rest by putting his business in her name. Of course, this was also a sham. Carol said that he always showed her papers about the business whenever she was cleaning or cooking, so she never really got a chance to inspect them properly. Perhaps if she had, she may have discovered his lies. Richard started to show his hand after his marriage to Carol. He lied that he had a boat fixing business, which meant he had to be away and around the country for long days at a time. But in truth, he was scamming another woman, and that scam required his physical presence. Carol grew suspicious of his behavior and decided that she would snoop around and see what she could find. One day, she received a disturbing text from another woman claiming to be her husband's lover. And that's when Richard's tower of lies began to come crumbling down. Carol phoned the woman, and they had a 2-hour-long chat where they discovered they had both been scammed by Richard. Both women quickly sprung into action and contacted the police, and an investigation was immediately launched. However, Carol made sure not to confront Richard immediately. She was still holding out hope that she would be able to recover some of her money. Unfortunately for her, she never got her money back. Throughout all this, Richard maintained his routine and continued to target new victims. Just 3 months after discovering her husband's real life, Carol found out about a potential third victim. She had been snooping through his emails and discovered that another woman was about to sell her home to fund a shady business owned by Richard. Carol sprung into action and quickly wrote to the victim to warn her. By then, the police had seen enough to arrest Richard. However, he skipped bail the first opportunity he had and led the police on a chase that lasted several weeks. But even Richard, as slippery as he was, could not run forever. When he was eventually caught by the police, they discovered several phones on him. It was obvious that he had one phone for each victim and that he was unrepentant as they come. He was taken to court and was jailed for 10 years for his troubles. Surprisingly, Richard does have a real wife that he's 100% honest with. Her name is Janet Flowers, and he married her back in 2008. She says he scammed her too, but he still has a marital relationship with her. Unsurprisingly, she's the only one he had gotten married to. If he were prone to romanticizing the lives of career criminals, we would have said she was his one true love. Number 2, Kay Ferguson. Kay Ferguson got a divorce and was looking for love. Instead, she got scammed twice and then was brainwashed to run a scam herself. Kay Ferguson was a financial officer for the Mawala Water Ski Club. She got divorced from her husband in 2020 and then decided to join an online dating site for people in their 50s. That was when she met the first person who scammed her. Her first scammer was a man who blackmailed her into sending him $130,000 under the threat of sending her explicit images to her children. After sending the money and dealing with that scam, Kay encountered a man named William David Rodovan, who said he was an engineer who traveled often for work. They became close, and One day, while they were talking, Kay heard a loud bang, and David hung up. A few days later, he called her back and said that he'd been in a horrible explosion that killed a majority of his workers and that he needed cash to pay out to their families. At first, she only sent the little money she had, but he became incessant, and Kay decided to start stealing from her company to give to David. She withdrew money from a Mawala Water Ski Club about 27 times and paid about $1 million to David in total. Her scam was discovered by the CEO of the club when he visited her home, and she told him about it. She was promptly arrested and taken to court. The judge, who saw her case, said that she was also a victim and was merely a lonely woman who'd been victimized by successive scammers. He sentenced her to 3 years of intensive correction and ordered her to repay the club. She's paid around $300,000 of her total debt, but a lot of it is still outstanding. Number 1. Doctorate in Scamming. Sebastian Asbury simply can't help himself. He's been convicted of fraud a whopping 66 times. Sebastian is a scammer who's posed for many different positions. He has posed as an MI5 agent, a lord, a Royal Navy officer, a banker, a landscaper, a property developer, and a shipping magnate. In one of his most successful scams, he was able to defraud a woman and her daughter of £100,000 by posing as a wealthy marine officer. It was an audacious romance scam that he pulled off by targeting his victim on the website plentyoffish.com. But he didn't just do romance scams. He did all kinds of scams. He once pretended to be a car salesman so that he could swindle 4 men out of £25,000 to lease luxury cars that didn't exist. The extraordinary thing about Sebastian is that he's been convicted 66 times before. For his last stint in jail, he served 12 months of a 2-year sentence and was released on the condition that he would stop requesting money from potential clients for services not yet rendered. Just a few months after getting out of jail, Sebastian breached this rule by posing as a landscaper on MyBuilder.com. He called his business New Forest Landscape and Design, but in reality, it was all a front to get new victims. In time, he swindled one David Russell out of £3,000. Mr. Russell paid the money up front for a landscaping job and was shocked when a few days later, the account of the business he conversed with was deleted off MyBuilder.com. According to Mr. Russell, this scam left him with feelings of hopelessness and stupidity. He even said he was now unnecessarily cynical and was even scared of making a bank transfer for a car because of the fear of getting ripped off again. Astonishingly enough, Sebastian's lawyer said that he had simply gotten carried away by compulsive spending habits. The lawyer argued that Sebastian doesn't go into these ventures intending to scam people. After all, the lawyer said, he had delivered these services to others. What happened was that he spent too much on personal expenses and simply no longer had the means to deliver the services to Mr. Russell. His lawyer argued that Sebastian wasn't a fraud, but a bad accountant. The judge presiding over the case did not agree and instead sentenced Sebastian to 2.5 years in prison. He was also ordered to pay back £1,500 to his victim. You never do anything spontaneous. Those were the words spoken to the then 36-year-old Acacia Windenot by her friend before she went on a date with Wilson Jackson, the man who would consume the next few years of her life for all the wrong reasons. Widenot's life truly changed when she received a friend request and a follow-up Facebook message from Jackson. On the surface, Jackson seemed like a genuine guy. He wore nice clothes in his pictures, and they even shared 4 mutual friends. His expression on the photos oozed charm, intelligence, and confidence. Jackson's message was, "What's up, beautiful?" Confirmed these impressions. "What's up, beautiful?" wasn't an uncommon first message for Widenot to find in her DMs. It's a message that she's used to getting. Nevertheless, Jackson stuck out like a well-dressed, confident thumb. To his "What's up, beautiful?" Widenot responded with a suspicious "Hello." But it was enough to get a response from Jackson. He continued the Facebook message convo with Widenot for several weeks before asking her on a date. During those weeks, Widenot became close to Jackson. She found out he wasn't a catfish after they FaceTimed on a few occasions. They spoke on the phone, talking about their mutual love of sports, particularly football. Jackson asked her about the 9 years she served in the Air Force, and Widenot answered, telling him all about her time abroad. Jackson listened to every word. In fact, Widenot got the impression that he cared about her, especially when he offered to fly Widenot from her home in Scottsdale, Arizona, out to his house in LA for Christmas. Widenot's original plans were to spend Christmas with her best friend, but the plans were canceled at the last minute. Now, left with no holiday plans, Widenot was still on the fence about accepting Jackson's offer. This was not something she'd normally do. Widenot's friend eventually convinced her to let Jackson buy her a ticket to LA and finally do something spontaneous. Widenot packed her things and left for the airport. Earlier, Jackson sent Widenot a screenshot of the boarding pass he'd bought for her. Everything seemed to be in order. Not to mention, Weedanot had finally found someone she liked who could meet her expectations. However, when she got to the airport, employees said her ticket was invalid. Weedanot, assuming something must have gone wrong during the purchasing process, called Jackson to get things sorted out. But when Jackson answered the phone, he didn't offer a solution. Instead, he insisted the ticket must be valid. Weedanot explained that the flight would leave soon and she needed a ticket to LA pronto. So Jackson instructed Weedanot to buy a ticket at the airport. He promised to pay her back when she got to LA, and to prove something was going on with the ticket he initially bought, Jackson sent Weedanot screenshots of him dealing with the bank. Weedanot says she proceeded to buy a ticket to LA and boarded the plane. Her plane landed at LAX in the late hours of the night. Jackson picked her up and took her to the movies. Weedanot recalls how he was in person just as charming, fun, and kind as he seemed on FaceTime. Jackson asked her about Weedanot's future, her career aspirations, and any wild, crazy dreams she harbored. In the morning, like a true gentleman, he cooked her breakfast, a classic combination of bacon and eggs. After they ate breakfast, Jackson took Weedanot back to the airport. On Monday, her second full day back home, Weedanot noticed over $3,000 was missing from her bank account. Weedanot scanned her card's transaction history and discovered where the purchases were made. The largest transaction was a $2,500 transfer to another account. The other two payments for a plane ticket and items at a fast food restaurant. All the money charges were billed from California. Weedanot knew exactly who had used her card. So, not long after seeing the charges, Weedanot filed a police report against Jackson. She wanted Jackson apprehended as soon as possible. Unfortunately, the police didn't share her desire for revenge. When Weedanot called the Scottsdale police, they deferred her to the Los Angeles police, who boomeranged Weedanot right back to Scottsdale police, telling her she'd have to file her report with them. Most people would give up, as $3,000 might not be a big deal. But Weedanot didn't care about the money. Instead of moving on, Weedanot started her own investigation into Jackson. Jackson had already blocked her number, so asking her suspect questions over the phone was not an option. With no prior background in research, Weedanot began investigating Jackson. She started with the basics. Where did Jackson live? Even though she'd been to his house, Weedanot couldn't remember Jackson's address, and without his address, finding Jackson would be very difficult. She couldn't find any home addresses linked to the purchases on her bank statement, but she did find the address of the fast food restaurant. After finding the restaurant address, Weedanot searched every apartment complex in the area and, with the help of her memory, found the apartment complex she stayed at with Jackson. She remembered Jackson taking her to a tall building, so tall that they had to park in an underground parking garage. So, Weedanot narrowed her search to tall apartment buildings with underground garages. She also remembered being close to a movie theater on a noisy LA street. Using these very specific criteria, Weedanot found a potential match. Just to be sure it was the building she stayed at, the rookie sleuth looked up the floor plans, then based on her memory of walking through the rooms and hallways, determined this was the place. Weedanot called the building's phone number and asked the clerk if a resident named Will Jackson lived there. The clerk said no, and Weedanot felt a dreadful epiphany wash over her. Will Jackson was not his real name. Weedanot kept digging. She used methods she initially learned from MTV's Catfish, such as reverse Google image searches on Jackson's Facebook page. Eventually, one of those reverse searches yielded a link to a social media account under a different name. The account had an email written in the bio. Weedanot dug deeper into the email account and discovered it belonged to someone named Sincere Jackson. Weedanot kept digging and Googled the name. The results were mostly unrelated, except for one article. The article was small, only 85 words, but it contained some vital info on Jackson. Oddly enough, the article's publisher was from Orlando, a local paper called the West Orlando News. In 2011, the Orlando News published an article on Jackson, saying that the police department were searching for victims willing to come forward and testify against Jackson. Alongside the victim's story was a mugshot of Jackson, who Weedanot easily recognized. The real question was, who are these victims? And what did Jackson do to them? Was it similar to what he did to her? Detective Weedanot would soon find out. In 2007, a Florida woman, who gave reporters the alias Shonda Porter, dated Jackson. She described him as a snake who could shed his skin on command and become anyone he needed to be. But that isn't how Jackson saw himself. Porter dated Jackson long enough to notice a large tattoo on his back, written in bold, daring letters, "Outlaw." Weedanot would later discover, after some more online sleuthing, that Jackson grew up as anything but an outlaw. According to public records, Jackson was born in Daytona Beach, Florida. Contrary to his tattoo, Jackson was raised in a conservative Christian household. Growing up, he did everything he could to escape his family's culture. As a young man, Jackson attempted to start a rap career under the name Da Truth. However, Da Truth wasn't very good. Jackson spent his early years bouncing around Florida, mainly between Tallahassee and Orlando, all the while claiming to his many girlfriends he was playing football and writing bars. In reality, Jackson was learning how to scam people, specifically successful young women on social media and dating apps. These girls saw Jackson the same way we do not had. Handsome, well-dressed, tall, fit-looking man with charm to impress even the most skeptical women. He used these attributes to lure dozens of women into trusting him. After contacting other victims and hearing their stories, we do not discovered Jackson's operation. She also realized how similar her story was to other victims. On a basic level, all the other victims, including Weedonot, had a few common experiences. They were contacted by Jackson, usually online, talked with him for a while, then he asked them for a favor or some kind of big purchase with the promise of reimbursement, after which Jackson would either not pay them back or steal their bank information and disappear, seemingly without a trace, until he met Weedonot, of course. She was the only victim who cared enough to track him down. In fact, no one did more than her in finding so-called Will Jackson, whose birth name was Wilson Edward Jackson. However, he used the name Sincere often, which is why Weedonot had such a tough time finding him. But when she did, Weedonot finally saw how extensive Jackson's scamming truly was. Before she continued her research on the other victims, Weedonot contacted a professional, then 55-year-old LAPD Detective Stephanie Kratzschier. By 2018, when Weedonot reached out to her, Detective Kratzschier had been investigating Jackson for a while, ever since the charming scam artist had moved to LA back in 2014. Weedonot could not arrest Jackson herself, but Kratzschier could. The Scottsdale sleuth presented Kratzschier with all the evidence she collected so far and convinced the LA detective that Jackson needed to be arrested immediately. Kratzschier, however, had a lot on her plate. The City of Angels was filled with scamming demons, and small-scale scams like Jackson's were not a number one priority. Nevertheless, the overworked and overwhelmed detective promised Weedonot she would arrest Jackson as soon as possible. Weedonot hung up the phone, feeling confident that Kratzschier would take care of the arrest. In the meantime, however, Weedonot could not let the case go. So far, Kratzschier only had 8 victims who'd reported Jackson to the authorities. Weedonot was determined to find more. Weedonot got to work quickly. She started using the very app Jackson used to contact her to look for other victims in Florida and California. The posts worked, and Weedonot started talking to several other victims from the two states. She even put them in touch with one another, creating a network of Jackson victims who could talk about their experiences. Kratzschier found 8 victims during years of investigation. Weedonot found 10 victims in just 1 month. These women, mostly African-American in their 30s, told each other how Jackson humiliated them. Though many of the victims shared their stories with other victims, most were reluctant to give their names to the media out of embarrassment. They all wanted to see some form of justice, though. Kratzschier promised Weedonot an arrest, with the deadline being April 2018. But after traveling to Afghanistan for a few months to work as a civilian air traffic controller, Weedonot looked at the calendar and noticed the month was January, the year 2019. Weedonot, in her extensive research, remembered reading how Jackson had gotten away. Most of the escapes were made possible by lazy investigators and prosecutors. Weedonot couldn't let another detective leave him under a pile of other cases. So she gave Kratzschier an ultimatum. Arrest Jackson, or Weedonot would file a complaint on the veteran detective who was set to retire any day now. Kratzschier chose the harder option and looked up Jackson on her computer. She found a warrant in his name for Grand Theft Auto and sent a team of officers to bring him in. Jackson was arrested on May 23, 2019 in Los Angeles. He was taken into police custody and hired a lawyer, but the lawyer left after Jackson's check bounced. His public defender convinced him to plead not guilty despite over 60 women coming forward to testify against him on 33 felony charges. In total, Jackson is believed to have collected over $200,000 from his victims, including Weedonot. Sadly, they'll never get that money back. But they can enjoy knowing that Jackson's face and reputation were smeared across news media outlets like Newsweek, The Daily Beast, and several local LA outlets. Click here to watch one of these next videos. And let us know in the comments section if you think girls that use guys for free dinners, even though they know they don't like them, should be a scam or not.